dogs up in hell for a hustler. Storm in the building. Kevin Robinson in the building. What's good, family? I usually wait for more people to arrive, but they can watch this back after the live. As you hear the instrumental in the background, Hell for a Hustler. And although people may complain and say, yo, you should have done the OG version, the reason why I'm choosing to do the Tupac and Outlaw Still I Rise album version of Hell for a Hustler is because you can hear, Tupac's lyrics even more clearer. You know, Tupac said himself when creating the album, creating the song, he felt he didn't have the luxury to be wasting time. So at times Tupac would do a rush job, and he said, leave it to the producers and the engineers, those who like being in the studio, to work on the song, you know, to do what they do. Tupac's job was just to go in there and write those raps. And that's what he did. It's like Tupac, it's like when you get hired to do a job, the people that hire you expect you to do a good job. So in that sense, Suge Knight actually hired Tupac to write rhymes, not produce beats, but to write rhymes. And Tupac was like, he was like a person that came to the job and he had college education. He had years of experience. He was almost too good for the job. But nevertheless, he still did a great job. And that's exactly what he did. So the reason why I chose this version of Hell for a Hustler, because they cleared it up, they cleaned it up. And you was able to hear Tupac's lyrics clearly, even though on the original, you heard Tupac clearly. But it was a lot of ad-libs and a lot of background. And I particularly like this version better. But we gonna get into it. Alex Lopez in the building. Zachariah, peace, Zachariah. Dog Velly in the building, what up, though? JD in the building, what's good? John X in the building, I ain't seen you here in a minute. Trudell in the building, what's going on, fam? Definitely watching. So let's get into it. You hear that? They did a good job with the remix. Now let's get into those lyrics. Because that's one thing Tupac did extremely well in this song. So it's going to be a lot of pausing on this particular joint. Because in my opinion, there's a lot of lines in here to dissect. That's just how deep Tupac was with his shit, man. Alex Lopez.
Get on your knees, nigga. Get on your knees and pray. Increase the doses, bustle with my closest dog living. Hell of prison, never losing my focus. I'm making money, moves mandatory. In the discussion, my past records tell a story. Pissing niggas with bust.
Now let me go back. Increase the doses, bust on whoever's closest. Now that right there, when he says increase the doses, you wonder what's coming next. So the next line, it says, bust on whoever's closest. So it's just like, damn, increase the doses, bust on whoever's closest. So you got to connect the lines right there. And in my opinion, I think that Tupac is talking about more ammunition and busting, because as this goes on, boy, he went crazy on this. So increase the doses, bust on whoever's closest, thug living, hell of a prison, never losing my focus. The thug living, it's a hell of a prison is what he's saying. This shit is still crazy to him, but he's still not losing his focus. Even though the way Tupac went out at the MGM, he never lost his focus, man. Even if the what the police officer said, which is true about Tupac, he's like, yo, what happened? Who shot you? And the last words from Tupac was, F you. He never lost his focus, even while he was leaking pints of blood, even while he couldn't breathe. He still managed to never lose his focus and tell that cop, fuck you. I ain't forget the past. I ain't forget my history with you people. Fuck you. Never lost his focus. Never lost his focus. So that's what that cop basically said. He said Tupac's last word was fuck you. How many other motherfuckers are able to get that kind of last word out there, and then the cop literally comes on there and tells the millions of viewers watching him, like, yo, yeah, Tupac told me, fuck you. That's powerful in itself to his dying day. That just goes to show you that Tupac lived the shit that he talked about to his dying day, bro. That was arguably, it had to be, because nobody else, Mopreme, I don't know how real it is with Snoop Dogg, you know what I mean? Afeni, Shock G, nobody else had a conversation with Tupac when he was in the hospital. But so, according to that police officer, his last words was fuck you. And he says, thug living, hella prison, never losing my focus. This shit has been, this kind of living was a prison for Tupac in a sense. It's hell for a hustler. This shit is hell when he say it, like, from day one, from my adolescent to my early teen, we're going to get into all that. I'm making money moves mandatory. End of discussion. My past records tell a story. Picture the niggas we rushing. He said, my past records tell a story. Picture the niggas we rushing. I'm making money moves mandatory. End of discussion. My past records tell a story. Picture the niggas we rushing. So I just like the way that Tupac was flowing on this shit. And I like the fact that, yo, he actually can rap. He actually can rhyme. But in between those raps and those rhymes and those lines, he is actually saying some real shit. My past records tell a story. Picture the niggas we rushing. So that right there can be, if you want to call it a double entendre, what past records? He could be talking about his music, or he could be talking about his criminal record with this the system. So it's like either take it either way. You know what I mean? But let's continue. Now, right there, that part is crazy. My past records tell a story. Picture the niggas we rushing and still busting. Still the cops come running. Till the cops come running. Ducking abandoned buildings. Ditching my gun. Oh boy, what a motherfucking feeling. Now that part right there, I'm not going to say Tupac. That might be one line Tupac embellished, or he might have really did that shit as a youngin. But what this reminds me of, what that actually reminds me of, and I'm going to say this real quick before I say that. Tupac's life was a movie in itself. You know what I mean? So in that sense, maybe he's right. But in the movie Juice, we seen Tupac run in the building and he ditched his gun. You know what I mean? We seen Bishop ditch his gun. But all that shit, bro, Tupac's life just adds on to everything that he did in his life, from the music to the movies. Like, all that is just, it's just him. It's just him. So let me walk inside this building and let me act like this and then walk and let me exit the building. You know what I mean? And let me just continue on with my day to day. So it's like, when I hear that line, ditching my gun, oh, what a mother, you know, ditching my gun, oh, what a motherfucking feeling. You know what I mean? It just makes me think about the movie Juice. But at the same time, he probably actually did that. I wouldn't know. But one thing we do know, he had an arsenal. He had an arsenal. Now let's continue. Now that part, I really love that. Ditching my gun, oh boy, what a motherfucking feeling. This part, I live the lifestyles of drug dealers, but now legitly. So it's just like, so when you see Tupac with all the jewelry, the Versace clothes, the Benz, the money, the diamond earrings and shit like that, the women. He was definitely living a lifestyle. It looked like a lifestyle in our community, because most people that lived like that was like pimps, hustlers, drug dealers, etc. Not necessarily business men, you know, businessmen that was about family and shit like that. But this, he was talking about some street shit, drug dealer shit. But he said, I lived the lifestyle of drug dealers, but now legitly. So he living legit though. His shit is legit. And I'm living that shit. So I just like that line, man. That's just me. Pardon me. Now that part right there, woo, that part right there is deep. But let me back up some. So he says, so I laugh till I'm crying when the Lord come get me. Wait, let me back up. I live the lifestyles of drug dealers, but now legitly. So I laugh till I'm crying when the Lord come get me. And actually, I'm reading the lyrics, but when I listen to it, it actually says, I laugh when I'm crying until the Lord come get me. That's what it sounds like to me. But as I'm reading the lyrics, it's saying, so I laugh till I'm crying when the Lord come get me. Now, let me listen to that one more time. Let me just see. See, yeah, he didn't say the Lord, he said the law. So I laugh till I'm crying when the law come get me. So it's just like that line is just, so I laugh till I'm crying until the law come get me. He said law, he really didn't say Lord. You know what I mean? So it's just like, he said, I laugh till I'm crying. So that shit is like crazy for this dude. This is what I said on the other live the other day. This is what I said on the other live the other day, man. It's just like, yo, the shit that Tupac spit, you had to live that in order to come up with this shit. You had to live that in order to come up with this type of shit that he's saying. So I laugh till I'm crying until the Lord come get me. Now the next line, this is wicked. That part right there. That part right there, that line, no baby mama drama, nigga miss me. Why plant seeds in the dirty bitch waiting to trick me? Not the life of me, living carefree until I'm buried. Now, it's almost smart. And it's at the same time what Tupac is saying. It's almost smart, but at the same time what Tupac is saying is like, no baby mama drama, nigga miss me. So it's like, when a lot of us, I'm not married, so I would say, yeah, this is my baby mama. And in a sense, it's really not a respectful thing to say at times, because most women don't want to be, a lot of women don't like that label, baby mama. And I don't know if men take offense being called, especially if they're not married to that woman, baby daddy. You know what I mean? These lines or these titles, they seem a little bit adolescent. But when you say, yo, this is my wife, or when she says, this is my husband, as opposed to, this is my baby daddy, or that's just my baby daddy, or that's my baby mama. You know what I mean? It just seems like, if that's your baby mama, why you ain't married? Or if you are together and you don't believe in marriage, some people might not even say, like, yo, that's not, a man would probably say, yo, that's my wife, even though, according to the papers, this American system, or you don't see no ring on her finger, some people still say that's wife or wifey. Wifey is still borderline touchy. You know what I mean? But no baby mama drama. So when you saying baby mama, that means like, yo, there's some type of drama that went there while I still refer to her as my baby mama. And then he says, nigga, miss me. Why plant seeds in a dirty bitch waiting to trick me? Now, that's a lot of shit. That's a lot of people. And I don't even want to really get to deep on it. But Billy Garland, Tupac's father, expressed something like this. You know what I mean? Did he express something like this? But I don't want to get too disrespectful, but y'all know what I'm talking about. Go back and listen to the Billy Garland interview and how the relationship between him and the Feeny, and how Tupac thought his father was dead or wasn't around, one of the two. The memory is making me draw a blank right now. But go back and listen to when Tupac said when he was in the hospital, first time he got shot, and he looked up and he seen an older person that looked just like him. So when you hear that shit, no baby mama drama, nigga, miss me. Why plant seeds in the dirty bitch waiting to trick me? It's almost like either Tupac, you know, he's speaking for the hustlers, because this song is called Hell for the Hustlers. So he's coming from his point of view. And I think he's also becoming from a lot of perspective of a lot of brothers in the hood that's going through this shit. Not all, but a lot that's going through this shit. Why plant seeds in the dirty bitch waiting to trick me? And when he says waiting to trick me, you know what I mean? That's the keep a nigga trick. You know what I mean? I'm all, oh, you ain't gonna leave me. I'm pregnant, nigga. Or if you don't stick by me, I'm taking you to court. And you're gonna be paying child support until the baby is 18 years old. That's a white man's system. So I can understand Tupac's anger, like, yo, no baby mama drama, nigga, miss me. Why plant seeds in the dirty bitch waiting to kiss me? Not the life of me. I'm living carefree. That's what he says. He says, not the life for me. I'm living carefree till I'm buried. And I'm going to say this to y'all real quick. And hopefully y'all listening, because this right here is important. Important. I don't know if y'all ever heard of the ancestor, Dr. Francis Quest Wilson. I don't know if y'all heard of the ancestor, Dr. Francis Quest Wilson. But she said one thing that black people in the poor environment or the neighborhood or the hood, one thing we got in common is poverty. So as teenagers, little boys, when little boys and little girls get bored, they go off and they experience with sex, especially when there's no real education in the household. There's no fathers in the household. And we are, you know, we can go back to how in the 60s and the 50s, when they made sure that there wasn't no black men in the household. So Dr. Francis Quest Wilson said, in order to fight white supremacy, you know, when these kids get bored, the little boy has sex with the little girl gets pregnant, and then the little boy goes about his life, and the little girl is there raising the baby. And look at, they start growing wild. That's thug life. The hate you gave little infants fucks everybody. But my point is, Dr. Francis Quest Wilson said, in order to combat white supremacy, all children, before you get married, before you decide to have children, or before you get married, you need to get as much education as you possibly can. You need to be well traveled. You need to learn different languages. You need to experience the world. You need to understand your finances. You need to understand the type of woman that you want, or she needs to understand the type of man that she want. And you need to learn all this shit by the time you're 30 years old. All this got to be learned by the time you're 30 years old. And when you're 30, then you have two more children, and you teaching the same thing that I just said. You teach those kids, like, yo, learn as much education as you possibly can. Travel the world. Learn other languages. Learn your finances. Learn all this other shit. And by the time you get 30, so you're raising educated children. But nobody is teaching that in these schools. Nobody is teaching that in these Western educational system. Nobody is teaching that at these Western academia institutes. They're not. But this is what Dr. Francis Quest Wilson said, what needs to be done in order to combat white supremacy. And that goes right back to Tupac's point of no baby drama, no baby mama drama, nigga, miss me. Why plant seeds in the dirty bitch waiting to trick me? Not the life of me, living carefree. So Tupac was basically on the right path, because he was 25 years old and he already spoke about the woman that he would have wanted, he spoke about the woman that he would want or he was in search for in that Vibe interview. And he was 25 and he didn't have no C's. Now it's crazy. Either Tupac had it, it was impotent, or had a learned sperm count, a low sperm count, or that nigga pullout game was top notch, or he just strapped up because he got around and he smashed a lot of women and he didn't have no children. So he made sure that he was carefree. So when you hear songs like Letter to My Unborn Child, a letter to my un, what's the other one? Letter to My Unborn Child, These Are My Words to My Firstborn, you know, things like that. Tupac left all these jewels here for the C's. A lot of y'all youngin', a lot of y'all are young that's on here. A lot of y'all are young that's on here, and Tupac left these seeds. So it's something to take, pay attention to. If you don't have no children just yet, man, get your education on, bro. Get your education on, bro. Learn different languages, because if you only know English, that's a damn shame. And that's like me. You better learn Spanish, all these beautiful women out here. You better learn how to speak some other languages from Africa, all those beautiful women out here. You better learn how to speak Asian, I mean China, Chinese, Japanese. You better learn how to speak other languages, bro, because that's how we communicate. Otherwise, if we can't communicate and you're like, what? We ain't never going to get along. Language is important. So I just had to stress that shit real quick. I told you we going to talk about the lyricism of this song, because Tupac just ain't writing shit that's just simple. It's not, bro. No baby mama drama, nigga, miss me. Why plant seeds in the dirty bitch waiting to trick me? Not the life of me, living carefree till I'm buried. Damn, he didn't want no children until he died. Now let's go on.
Why plant seeds in the dirty bitch waiting to trick me? Not the life of me, living carefree till I'm buried. And if they hear me, I'm busting them niggas until they scurry.
Not life of me, living carefree until I'm buried. And if they dare me, I'm busting them niggas until they scurry. So it's just like, motherfuckers just scattering. But I like the way he rhymed that shit. Not the life of me, living carefree till I'm buried. And if they dare me, I'm busting them niggas until they scurry. I'm clearly, like Tupac be rhyming, he's rhyming. He's doing that same shit Cassidy described. He's rhyming, he's rhyming words within the side, the sentences. It's you just gotta really listen to see how dope Tupac is. Cause all these other motherfuckers that think Tupac rhymed like the way Dave Chappelle did on that skit, you're absolutely mistaken, bro. For a lot of niggas that think Tupac is just Hennessy and enemies, he didn't say Hennessy at all in this song, Hell for a Hustler. So a lot of these haters just don't be listening, bro. They don't be listening. Let's continue.
Man, the military needs my artillery, watching over me through every murder scene.
I told you I'm going to be doing a lot of pausing, because every line is like important to me. I don't know how it is to you. But he says, I'm clearly a man of military means to my artillery, watching over me through every murder scene. He got a military mindset. Now, keep in mind, this is a brother that's 25 at the time. I don't know how true it is, but somebody said, yo, Tupac wrote this on September 6th. I don't know where they got that information from, but nevertheless, whether he was borderline 25 or he was 24, look at the mindset of that, bro. I'm military minded. He said, I'm clearly a man of military means to my artillery, watching over me through every murder scene. So they keeping their eyes on him. All this shit that's what's going on. It's just crazy, man. When Tupac got shot the first time, a lot of shit unfolded. A lot of shit unfolded. A lot of shit followed this dude. There was murders. Y'all know this, bro. This shit is documented. I ain't saying nothing that's too far-fetched, man. Scotty Boy says he does have a child, though. Phony phone in the building. LaQuasha not in the building. I don't even know if there ain't no haters up in here. But anyway... Now let's go on.
Military means to my artillery, watching over me through every murder scene. From adolescence to my early teens, though we was gonna die, selling dope to all the fiends, at times I'm on the drop.
Now that line right there, bro. That line right there, bro. From adolescence to my early teens, thought we was gonna die. That's messed up, bro, that a black child, us being that young, this is our mindset. From adolescence to my early teens, thought we was going to die. selling dope to all the fiends. At times I want to cry. Because look at the environment, bro. And he's going to tell you why he's crying in a second. Like, you got to pay attention to these lines, bro. I don't know if y'all really listening, but pay attention to these lines, because the shit that Tupac left behind, I told you, if you ain't listened to the beginning of this live, I said, like, yo, Tupac's focus was to write those lyrics. That was his job. That's why he was hired at Death Row. Do your job. You're a very experienced rapper. So, all right, I'm going to write some shit. I'm going to do my fucking job so well that the next employee that's coming here, he's going to have a hard time following me. There ain't been another motherfucking Tupac in this music industry since, but more or less in Death Row. And based on the shit that he was spitting, Snoop Dogg, Corrupt, no disrespect to them, they couldn't write shit like this, bro. They couldn't write shit like this if they ain't live it. I said that shit on my last live. Tupac is the lyricism. Tupac is the cadence, the punchlines, the metaphors, the double entendre. Tupac is the passion, the energy. So he says, from adolescence to my early teen, thought we was going to die selling dope to all the fiends. At times I want to cry, because he seen what that dope did to his mother. He seen what that dope did to the Black Panthers. He seen what that dope did to our community. This is why that him and Dr. Matula Shakur, rest in peace, came up with the Code of Thug Life. He seen how that shit was destroying us. But at the same token, what else we going to do? If we ain't going to unite and create a black nation, we going to get along. Nigga, I got to hustle. I got to get my shit. You heard him in Straight Ballin'. I'm up before the sunrise, first to hit the block. Little bad motherfucker with a pocket full of rocks. You know what I mean? It's not something that we want to do, but this is how the conditions was laid out. Systemic racism is real. You got to read in between the lines of what this nigga's saying. These lines I'm breaking down, when that nigga say hell for a hustler, this nigga is describing it. He's describing it. Selling dope to all the fiends, at times I want to cry. You probably seen dope fiends that were teachers. I got to say this. My cousin the other day ran into a homegirl. Beautiful sister. Beautiful sister. 34 years old. Maybe 34, 30, between 34 and 38. And she asked my cousin. She was like, yo, you wouldn't even think this shit. She was like, yo, where can I get some crack? Because I hear that shit is better than what it used to be. And a lot of people are doing it. So I just want to give it a shot. I want to try it. My cousin said he looked at her like, yo, don't do that shit. I used to sell that shit. My cousin used to sell that shit. I can't even describe the shit that motherfuckers did to get a piece of crack. Some shit about this fucking big, bro. I seen a lady literally fuck the fire hydrant because me and our young niggas, I was like maybe 15, 16. Her name was Shake It Down Mary. Real talk. And we was young. We made her fuck the fire hydrant. You know the top of the fire hydrant that they take off? That you gotta, to make that shit? Well, whenever way, there's like a, we made her do that shit. It was an older black woman, bro. So when I think back in that time, oh man, that shit is fucked up. But it was because of that drug. It's because of that drug. But also look what the drug did to the drug dealers. It made us not give a fuck. It desensitized us. It made us like, man, I don't give a fuck. Like, I don't give a fuck about my community, nigga. I give a fuck about this money. I give a fuck about this hustle, even though it's hell for a hustler, bro. Hang Tamek in the building. Somebody using R. Kelly. I gotta put you on pause. R. Kelly is my favorite singer of all time, so I can't allow you to come up here and, you know, doing the bullshit that you're doing. R. Kelly is my favorite R&B singer of all time. And LaQuasha not in the building? These haters is coming at me. So anyway, man, So when Tupac says that shit, bro, I hope y'all still there. I hope y'all listening. My numbers is fluctuating. They go up and down. I guess I'm not keeping people interested. I don't know what the fuck y'all niggas be wanting to hear me say. I don't know if you just want to see me just rapping the Tupac beats and going crazy and shit like that. I don't know what the fuck. You know what I mean? When I come on live, I don't know what niggas be wanting. I don't know the attention span of y'all. I really don't. I'm 51 years old, Slip and Roll Boxing in the building, salute. I'm 51 years old, so I don't know the attention span of a lot of y'all. I'm trying not to bore y'all. Let me know in the chat if you're not a hater, if I'm boring you. You know what I'm saying? Let me know in the chat if you're not a hater, if I'm boring you. But I'm breaking down Tupac's lyricism because that's what this channel was about. Tupac was lyrical. I ain't about the fucking gossip. And I said, when somebody disrespects Tupac's lyrics, you're disrespecting his message. So you listen, the shit I'm breaking down is my interpretation, but I don't think I'm too far-fetched. Let me continue. So he says, selling dope to all the fiends at times I want to cry. That part right there. And still, we try to change the past in vain. So we try to change the past, man. We try to change the past in vain. In vain means unsuccessful. It means no result. It means it didn't happen. It was pointless. We try to change the past in vain. Never knowing if this game will last. Feeling the shame of cocaine. He said the product of the devil. Am I selling my soul? Hold on. So that part right there goes right back to that initial line when I was telling you when he said something about selling dope to all the fiends. At times I want to cry. And then earlier he has said something. Increase the doses, busting whoever closest, never losing my focus. I'm making money moves mandatory under discussion. The bus to the cops come running, dishing my gun. Lifestyles of drug dealers, but now legitly. I think it was that line. It might have been that one. I'm living the lifestyles of drug dealers now legitly. You know what I mean? So he's living legitly. He feels like he's living legit. He feels like he came up in society. He feels like he can help out his people. You know what I mean? And without being judged and things of that nature. But he says, though, selling dope to all the fiends. At times I want to cry. And still we try to change the past in vain. Never knowing if this game will last. Feeling the shame of cocaine, the product of the devil. Am I selling my soul? Now, from my aspect, from where I come from, what I was always told, especially in the gods of earth, the 5% nation, although I'm not a 5%er, you know what I mean? But I know some of the teachings, the devil was the white man. And those who have bought those drugs in our community, we called the white man the devil. You know what I mean? Brand Nubian said that in the song, Wake Up. When they said, can the devil fool a Muslim? No, not nowadays, bro. Do you mean to say the devil fooled us 400 years ago? You know what I mean? So they was talking about the white man. So when he says of cocaine, the product of the devil, am I selling my soul? And when you look at movies, when you look at the TV show Snowfall, or when you hear about Freeway Ricky Ross, and you know where he was getting his connection from, rather he was working with somebody in, I don't even want to mention those three letters. But when you hear about that shit, you know what I mean? You ask about, it's them devils that's bringing that shit in here. And a lot of us was doing good, just selling weed, just being, you know, just calm and shit. But when that motherfucking cocaine hit and they learned from them Colombians or those people in South America how to turn that shit to rock. And when them niggas turn that shit to rock and niggas hit that shit, man, like the Brand Nubian said, head crack. When you saw the movie New Jack City, when New Jack City came out, it was the irony of it all, bro. When New Jack City first came out in 1991, I was 19, and it was the summer, so I probably was like, yeah, I was 18. It was summer of 1991, I was 18. And when that motherfucker G-Money told Nino Brown, he was like, yo, he showed him the crack, and he said, I ain't saying all that, but he said, they came back for the base. Man, I got my Jimmy sucked every night because of this little shit, bro. And that shit destroyed our motherfucking community, bro. I know it sounds like I'm preaching this shit like that, but this is hell for a hustler. A lot of you people talking about, you know, yo, play hell for a hustler. Yo, discuss hell for a hustler. Like, yo, you know, don't just, Tupac said, yo, don't just bop your head to his music, bro. Tupac told niggas that. Don't just bob your head to the music. Listen to what he's saying. And you tell me if it's real. And hold us accountable. So when you ask me to dissect, or when you ask me to talk about a Tupac song, bro, I'm 51 years old. I don't listen to that shit with a shallow ear just to come back and say, yo, Nas couldn't fuck with Tupac. Oh, Jay-Z couldn't fuck with Tupac. Or Eminem couldn't fuck with Tupac. Nah, fuck all that shit. I would say like, yo, them niggas wasn't spitting what Tupac was spitting at all. I don't give a fuck what songs you bring to me. Because this dude is spitting his life. And at the age that he was spitting, this shit is very profound, bro. You don't hear. You ain't never, Jay-Z talk that hustling shit all the time. You ain't never heard Jay-Z say in his rhymes, like, yo, selling dope to all the fiends, at times I want to cry. That nigga ain't say that shit. He ain't give a fuck. That nigga Jay-Z said, if y'all niggas ain't talking about large money, what's the point? A lot of them niggas is just all about getting more money and getting more money, moving weight, bringing in kilos, and fucking up our neighborhood, my nigga. So much so that everybody wanted to be a drug dealer, but nobody wanted to own businesses. That's why we ain't got a lot of businesses now like we should. No disrespect to the foreigners that are here. They're humans. But in this American system, yo, look, all them Asian businesses in our community, can we go to their community and set up black businesses? All those Arab businesses in our communities, we call them Ox, Akis, in our community, can I go to Arabia or Arab, wherever they from, and set up business in their community? Ask yourself that shit, bro. Hang Timex says, Slim 400 in the building. Payne 82 said, we having church today. That's because of Tupac. If we having church today, that's because of Tupac. Hell for a hustler. Hang Time says, and talk about the other side of the story, the good, the bad, and the decisions you take. That's a fact, family. Zachariah says, since Biggie was originally supposed to be part of Thug Life, you think the OG version of Running from the Police could have been on the Thug Life album? Yeah, possibly. Hang Time says, don't just talk about the money and jewelry about drug dealers. Talk about the getting shot and killed, sent to prison. That's exactly what this hell for a hustler shit is, bro. So let me finish this shit off. Let me finish this verse off. This game will last, feeling the shame of cocaine, the product of the devil. Am I selling my soul? Got to a small time living. Niggas telling me no, I got mine. Fuck them up, the suckers. That's the mentality. Jealous ass buses, make it hell for us. So he says, of cocaine, product of the devil. Oh, product of the devil. Am I selling my soul? I can't skip over that. He says, let me say that line again. Never knowing if this game will last, feeling the shame of cocaine, the product of the devil. Am I selling my soul? Am I selling my soul, bro? That shit is so fucking deep, bro. So you got these niggas out here. We talk about integrity. You got Cat Williams who came out a lot of people and shit about integrity and shit like that. How a lot of motherfuckers ain't got integrity. How a lot of motherfuckers is, you know, selling their soul to get rich. A lot of people think people like Kevin Hart, Steve Harvey, and et cetera. You know what I mean? There's other people, especially if they don't talk about the issues that take place that's plaguing our communities. You know, we may say that they sold their souls to get where they at. Tupac is telling you right here as selling drugs, bro. The product of a devil that didn't come from our people. It came from the enemy. Am I selling my soul? Because this shit is making me fast money. This shit is making me fast money. This shit got women looking at me. But it got niggas hating. It got the jealousy. It got all this other shit. And it's destroying my community. It got people breaking in their own fucking home, selling their TV, their food, their food stamps, selling their children. Am I selling my soul? Ask yourself that shit. That shit is so fucking real. A lot of these niggas wasn't rapping like this, bro. And a lot of niggas wasn't rapping like this. The shit that Tupac is saying. So the shit that I broke down, and I've been talking for 40 minutes. I'm very loquacious. Look that word up if you don't know what that means. I'm very loquacious, as you can see. And as you can hear. But he says, am I selling my soul? He said, I got tired of small time living. Niggas telling me no. I got mine. Fuck the mother suckers. That's the mentality. Jealous ass busters make it hell for a hustler. So he said, I got mine. That's what a lot of niggas say. You know what I mean? It's like when Sticky Fingers said in that song, Last Days, if they gonna get it from somebody, it might as well be me. Type shit. You know what I mean? It's like, niggas didn't get, but you heard that shit in Wu-Tang album. Was it Cream? Can It Be So Simple? Yo, 2 for 5, 2 for 5. Niggas got garbage up there. It's, get it from over here, 2 for 5. Niggas selling that shit, 2 pieces of crack for $5, bro. So am I selling my soul? Am I selling my soul would be the question. Am I selling my soul? And then it added on to that, the product of the devil. And then that shit makes it even more profound. The product of the devil. And what do people say they sold? They talk about Jay-Z sold his soul, Beyonce sold his soul, so many other, you know, so many artists in the industry sold to the devil. And this nigga Tupac said cocaine, the product of the devil. Am I selling my soul? Look how deep that is. Y'all niggas want me to break down hell for a hustler? Really listen to what Tupac's saying. I told niggas, when you disrespect Tupac's lyrics, you're disrespecting the message. Because the only thing you just focusing on is the messenger. And Tupac don't mind you showing. He doesn't mind you showing him love. He loves that. That's, give me the accolades. Give me the flowers. Show me love. But nigga, are you listening to my message? When I tell you I will spark the brain, motherfucker, I'm telling you the words that I say will spark the brain. I told you niggas to smile. It's going to be some shit that you're going to see that's going to make it hard to smile in the future. But through all the rain and pain, you gotta have a sense of humor. You gotta keep your head up through all this bullshit. Smile. Told a black woman, keep your head up. He told black women, baby, don't cry. He told Ed Gordon, I can never be a sellout. If niggas think I make Dear Mama and Keep Your Head Up and Brenda's Got a Baby as a fluke, you won't hear another motherfucking song got my motherfucking mouth. He was giving you a fucking message, bro. Hell for a hustler. Let me stop right there. He said, no insanity plea for me. I ride the beef till I burn. Now, that's like a double entendre in itself. Insanity means in crazy, mental illness. A plea means like, you know, this is my plea. This is what I'm asking. This is what I'm saying. Or it could mean like, Your Honor, he gonna plead my defendant. Please, insanity, Your Honor, as why he committed the crime. Tupac was saying, nah, there ain't no insanity plea. Nigga, I ain't crazy. I ride the beef till it burns. The beef till it burns. So ride, you know what I mean? We know what ride means. So this shit is on. This is on, nigga. It's popping, my nigga. But the beef till it burns, we know what beef is. Biggie told you what beef was, too. But we know what beef is. But also, the double entendre would be, I ride the beef till it burns. You cook beef. And a lot of us, LaQuasha in the building, salute. Everybody salute Queen LaQuasha in the building. So I ride the beef till it burns. So it's just like, nah, we beefing, nigga. I ain't going to end this shit. I ain't ending this shit. You know what I mean? And you cook beef, I like my shit well done, nigga. I don't like my shit medium rare. I don't like my shit bloody. Now that part right there is crazy. Let me just start. No insanity plea for me. I ride the beat till I burn. Censor me and bar your kids from the lessons I learned. So censor me. You know what I mean? So it's just like what we was talking about with the message. So you want You don't want Tupac to, you don't want his message to get out there. So the best thing that a lot of these niggas can do nowadays, oh, Tupac was gay. Oh, Tupac just rhymed Hennessy and enemies. Oh, Tupac was with the Bloods. Oh, Tupac, you know, was just a troublemaker. Oh, Tupac raped the girl. Oh, Tupac did this. Oh, Tupac, censor him. And bar your kids. Bar your kids means, B-A-R, means bar means to prevent from, prevent someone from doing something. So you're preventing the children to listening. You're preventing your children from you're preventing your children from hearing Tupac's message. So he says, censor me, bar your kids from the lessons I learned. You don't want to hear the Tupac is giving you the lessons he learned. Bro, again, this is a 25-year-old man, bro. This is a 25-year-old man. I can go back in 1996. I argue those before Tupac album came out, before everybody else. Tupac dropped in what, February? And listen to the songs. Listen to the albums that came out after that. Bro, you don't think them niggas was studying and listening to Tupac? So if any, and so if any, if I say, and there wasn't nobody spitting like that in 96, and you might say, nah, Nas was, or Jay was, or, you know, somebody else was, you know what I mean? Like, nah, y'all wasn't, they was not spitting like this. That realism. Actually spitting his life. Censor me. Dan Quayle tried to censor him. C. Dolores Tucker tried to censor him. Bob Dole tried to censor him. A lot of people try to censor him. People try to stop their kids from listening to him. Ed Gordon asked Tupac, like, yo, but you getting pimped. And Tupac said, I ain't getting pimped. He said, everybody's getting pimped. But it's just like, for how long you gonna get pimped? He said, because I'm writing the curriculum of these white kids out here. If I say I do this and do this and do that, those white, he said, I guarantee you, those white kids in the future are gonna be doing the same shit. And what did Big Gip, and I'm gonna give you an example. What did Big Gip recently say about Eminem? Changing the color barriers and all this other shit. Eminem constantly gets compared to Tupac for some strange reason. I ain't gonna say no idiotic reasons or none of that shit, but Eminem definitely said Tupac was lyrical. But Eminem was definitely oppressed by Tupac's lyrics. Eminem definitely put passion and a lot of energy in his music. Eminem even rhymed like Tupac, and I'm not really bigging up Eminem, but I'm expressing something right now. Eminem even rhymed like Tupac in Hail Mary, verbatim, when he dissed Benzino. So when Tupac says, nah, it's not who am I's getting pimped, Tupac says, I'm writing the curriculum for those white children out there, and they're going to do as I say. They're going to emulate the shit that I'm saying. They're going to do it. They're going to do it. And Eminem is a prime example. Matter of fact, it would be the number one example. The greatest, probably the greatest selling artist in hip hop, bro. Just to be factual. But he learned a lot from Tupac. And when Tupac tells Ed Gordon, like, nah, bro, I'm writing the curriculum for them white kids as well. So who's getting pimped? Them niggas want to beat us. So when he says shit like that, man. Hold up. Where am I at? So he says, censor me, bar your kids from the lessons I learned. Let's go back. I love that shit, bro. And censor me and bar your kids from the lesson I learned. And in turn, I'm hostile. Guess you can call me antisocial. Niggas shaking like they caught the Holy Ghost when I approach you. Woo! That's a dope ass punchline. That's a dope ass metaphor right there. Niggas say Tupac ain't got metaphors. What? How many motherfuckers know what the Holy Ghost is? How many motherfuckers know where that term even comes from? If you ain't never been to a black church, then you honestly don't know what he means by niggas shaking like they caught the Holy Ghost. You don't know what that shit means. That's a metaphor. It's a metaphor. But let me go back. He says, and in turn, I'm hostile. Guess you can call me antisocial. So this world has, let me say this, hell for a hustler. I told you everything I'm describing ain't pretty. This shit ain't no heaven. You niggas wanted me to you people wanted me to dissect Hell for a Hustler and want me to play it? I'm not just doing this shit to just bob my head to the fucking beat. I repeat, Tupac said, don't just bob your head to the beat. Listen to what he's saying, and you tell me if it's real, and hold us accountable. So when I listen to Pac songs, nah, bro, I'm listening to the fucking message, bro. I'm listening to the lyricism, and the lyricism brings forth the message. I'm not listening to just listening to that shit just so I can say, yo, Tupac is better than Nas, Jay-Z. I'm not saying that shit. That's not why I'm listening. I'm gathering information. I'm gathering information, bro. Information. I like that. I'm gathering information, bro. So he says, in turn, I'm hostile. Censor me and bar your kids from the lessons I learned. And in turn, I'm hostile. So that shit pissed him off. That you try to censor me and ban your kids from listening to me. So now I'm hostile. I guess you could call me antisocial. Because niggas shaking like the Holy Ghost when I approach you. Niggas is shivering. Niggas is scared. Niggas talk a lot of shit, but that's after I'm gone. Because they fear me in the physical form. You couldn't even write a line like that. That's not even on this song. Niggas talk a lot of shit, but that's after I'm gone. Because they fear me in the physical form. You couldn't even write a rhyme like that if you didn't live it. If you didn't really experience that shit. If you didn't witness that shit. It's like when Tupac approaches you. Going back to this line, when I approach you and you shaking and you shook and you scared. And you know what I mean? And you don't know if I'm going to spit on you. When Tupac comes out the courthouse or whatever he came, it's like, just spitting on motherfuckers. How many people you ever seen do that? Nobody. You ain't even got to answer that. How many people you ever seen just coming out of wherever Tupac was coming out of court or whatever, spitting at the media? Nobody. Nobody coming out spitting. So you don't know how this man is going to react, bro. He says, I'm hostile. I guess you can call me antisocial. I lost my part. He said, I'm hostile. I guess you can call me antisocial. Niggas shaking like they caught the Holy Ghost when I approach you. That line is so dope, bro. Niggas is shaking like the Holy Ghost when I approach you. If you ain't never been to a black church, if LaQuasha in the building, if she been to church, she seen people catch that caught the Holy Ghost. She know what that shit mean. I know what that mean. I seen that in my young life. Do I believe in the Holy Ghost? No. But I know exactly what Tupac is saying. Stop right there. Stop right there. This motherfucker Tupac says, try to politic before I smoke him like Sun Tzu. Nigga, do it to these snitches until it's done to, before it's done to you. Let me say that line again because I effed it up. Try to politic before I smoke him like Sun Tzu. Nigga, do it to them snitches before it's done to you. So Tupac tried to politic. Tupac tried to be reasonable. He tried to be sensible. He tried to come to him on some other shit. He tried to just like, yo, it was all peace. It was all calm. And it was all this just to weaken his enemy's guard. You know what I'm saying? Just to weaken his enemy guard. I'm like, oh, shit. Maybe Tupac ain't hostile. You know what I mean? Maybe he is a nice guy. Keep in mind, this is Tupac approaching the enemy. This is Tupac approaching the enemy on some calm shit like, yo, what's good, bro? Yo, what's good, man? Blah, blah, blah. Laughing and giggling. And then, bow, smokes him. He said, try to politic before I smoke him like Sun Tzu. Nigga, do it to them snitches before it's done to you. Now, Tupac gave you the quote unquote nigga version of the Sun Tzu quote. Nigga, because Sun Tzu didn't say that, but I guarantee you, you can find many quotes that are very similar to that Sun Tzu, similar to Tupac's quote, nigga, do it to them snitches before it's done to you. I guarantee you can find some shit like that. The art of war. That's exactly what Tupac is talking about. This is the art of war. It wasn't that many motherfuckers talking about Sun Tzu at that time. It wasn't that many people talking about Master Sun, Chang Ging. It wasn't too many people talking about him at that time, especially a 25-year-old. You go back and you might have heard it on a... I'm not even going to say that because I don't even want to bring other motherfucking niggas in discussion. It wasn't that many people talking about that shit, bro. Nah, not at all. He said, try to politic before I smoke him, like Sun Tzu. Nigga, do it to them snitches until it's done to you. I messed up again. Nigga, do it to them snitches before it's done to you. So get them before they get you. But politic, be sensible. Be, you know what I mean? Sun Tzu said some shit like, yo, be at places your enemies won't even expect you to be. Catch them niggas off guard and smoke them. That's basically what Tupac is saying, bro. I don't know what this dude, Troy Anthony, gave me the up, you know, the rolling eyes emoji. I might have to block him. You know, shit like that fucks up my concentration. Let me put him on the timeout. And maybe he'll say something differently. Maybe he'll lead something differently. But don't worry, I'm gonna go back and read these motherfucking chats. It ain't over with, nigga.
When I approach the drop, I'll say before I smoke them, like Sun Tzu. Niggas doing to these snitches before it's done to you. And if the cops come arrest me in the evening, best believe they're coming from my dogs in the morning.
Now this part right here, he said if the cops come arrest me in the evening, best believe they're coming from my dogs in the morning. So I feel like the cops, what he's saying right here, now this could be the wrong interpretation, but I feel like when Tupac says, if the cops come arrest me in the evening, best believe they're coming for my dogs in the morning. So what happened is that they got the head, they got the leader, they got the brother at the top. They got him. So now when Tupac's followers or his soldiers, they can't communicate with him, because I was always told one thing when you're in war, one thing you're supposed to wipe out is communication with your leader, with the general. Because once you wipe out communication with your general or with the commander, you know, the soldiers are left on their own. You know what I mean? They don't know what to do. So they got to get on some military mind and they got to be alert and be aware. But when there's no contact, they need to know. Now that the communication has been cut off, they have to assume that the enemy is on the move and the enemy is about to attack you. They came for your leader at night and they about to get you in the morning. So when Tupac says, if the cops come arrest me in the evening, best believe they coming for my dogs in the morning. But then he says this.
And if I die by a slug, the death of a truther.
And he said, but he's also letting you know, but if I die by a slug, the death of a true thug, tell me where my niggas mourn me. So Tupac is letting you know, if the cops do come in the evening, I'm going all out, bro. That's the death of a true thug. I said that shit in the where he said, an ambitious of a rider. If you're going to be a man, then you pick the way you leave. If you're going to be a man, then you pick the way you leave. And he said, if I die by a slug, the death of a true thug, tell me what my niggas mourning. Shit like that just goes to show you that it wasn't nobody spitting like this in 96, bro. Everybody will tell you, like, nah, Tupac always spoke that death shit. Death around the corner, headlines reading murder to death, 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 death. Shit like that just goes to show you that it wasn't nobody spitting like Pac, bro. There wasn't nobody on that kind of mindset, that kind of thinking. Like, some people think, like, nah, that nigga, you know, he bought that shit on himself. He bought that shit in his life. He kept bringing that shit into existence. No! I hate when people say that shit. Tupac spoke his death into the universe, and the universe granted it what he always wanted. Nah, bro. This is a war zone. This is hell for a lot of us, bro. There was people before. There was Emmett Till was killed when he was 14. There was a little boy, I'm forgetting his name. He was executed at the age of what, 12, 13? There was boys that was being fed to alligators. So they was used as alligator bait. just so they can catch the crocodile or the alligator, so they can make alligator boots or crocodile boots and purses and jackets. So don't say that shit. The motherfuckers didn't. They didn't ask for death. We live in a motherfucking, a hellish type of society, a hellish type of world. And it's not a black man's world at all. It's not. It's not. So when he says shit like that, bro, don't talk about Tupac. Now, Tupac brought his death on his own self. No, bro. You know how many innocent bystanders out here caught it? Rest in peace to this little girl. I think her name was Latasha or Letitia. Oh my God, I'm forgetting the young girl name, man. But in 2005, she was 10 years old outside playing. She's outside playing with her brothers and mother near, went in to get him a bottle of water, came back out. She seen her 10-year-old daughter on the ground bleeding, bro. Died from a niggas was shooting 100 yards away and the bullet came flying and it hit her. So don't say Tupac brought that shit on himself because he talked about death. Nah, his mother, I told you. Tupac mother said, you want to save the world. Don't you know they're going to kill your black ass? And that's it. It wasn't that he brought that shit on. This is the kind of society that we live in. This is why a lot of our black people, this is why we ain't really got no real motherfucking black leaders. A lot of us look up to rappers and actors and athletes. Niggas don't pay attention to Dr. Claude Anderson. Niggas don't research Dr. John Clark, Dr. Ben, Ivan Sertima. No Marcus Garvey. Niggas don't do the knowledge. A lot of niggas don't do the knowledge. We too busy following fucking celebrities and actors. When Tupac told you, we don't need no more rappers, no more basketball players, no more football players. He said, we need more mathematicians. We need more scientists. We need more doctors. We need more men, women. We need more of that. We need teachers. He said, we don't need no more entertainers, bro. This nigga Tupac said that shit back in 1992. And that's all we do is look up to entertainers. As they're like, they are fucking leaders, bro. The fuck they building? These motherfuckers that got money, what are they building? That's really competing with the people that we really depend on. There ain't no motherfucking black Walmarts. A lot of us shop at Walmarts. A lot of us shop at Sam's Club, BJ's. A lot of us shop at grocery marts. A lot of us shop at Whole Food Markets. Whole Food Market is owned by Jeff Bezos. He got 515 Whole Food Markets and he got 500,000 acres of land growing the produce and shit that we eat. The same with Bill Gates. Y'all niggas wanted me to break down hell for a hustler. I told you, when you break down Tupac's lyrics or when you disrespect Tupac's lyrics, nigga, you disrespecting the message, bro. Let's continue. Because we almost done. Tell me what my niggas mourn me, getting blowed out. High, watch me, he said, blowed out so that they smoking weed. High, watch me murder the bird before he testify. Strikes, walking close to my third. I live a troubled life. Now, I'm breaking down the bars, but when you really go back and you listen, the way Tupac put this shit together, like if he was really a braggadocious rapper, you would be like, damn. This nigga really is braggadocious. He really spitting this shit. But it's just that he put this shit together. Like when you read Tupac, the way he rhymes, you would almost think he's bragging about, I'm the best MC. I'm the best fucking rapper. I'm out here, nigga. I'm the best fucking trapper. Kill it. Like, it's like you would look at Tupac like a dope ass rapper. You know what I mean? But when you really focus in on what the fuck he's saying, it's just like, damn, this nigga rapping like in a battle against another MC or just bragging about being a dope MC like Rakim or Kane or somebody to that degree. But nah, this nigga is saying some real shit. So when this nigga says, hi, watch me murder the bird before he testify. Strikes, walking close to my third. I live a troubled life. So when he says, he's high, watch me murder the bird before he testified. So we call niggas what? Bird niggas. You know what I mean? We call them people like that. Bird ass nigga. You know, type of shit like that. Who's about to testify. Then he says strikes. Walking close to my third strike. If you get three strikes a certain, it might be everywhere now. The white man created the motherfucking law. Hell for a hustler. Once again, white man created the law. That's hell for a hustler. So that three strikes was invented for us. That's three strikes were invented for us. LaQuasha must not be in the building. Me running, my bad, what? My been running, what's good? So he says, let me go back, man. Hi, watch me murder the bird before he testifies. Strikes, walking close to my third. I live a troubled life. So he's facing about to face three strikes. And he said, when will niggas see they got us bleeding with three strikes? Remember he said that shit? Niggas need to pay attention to that shit. Tupac was giving you game at that young... Oh, man, bro. Some niggas be so focused on just Tupac. Oh, shit, Tupac with his bald head and his tattoo on his belly and the tattoos and his and the diamond in his ear and the bandanas and shit like that and the middle fingers. When this nigga telling you like, yo, the niggas is giving us three strikes. You niggas... He said, you better watch it. You better watch it or be a victim. Or be a victim in this white man's world. Y'all motherfuckers don't be listening. Some of y'all motherfuckers don't be listening, bro. Real talk. That's why I said Tupac is my leader. Is my leader. And if a motherfucker think that's crazy, somebody point out a leader right now. Point out a black leader right now. Point them out. Matter of fact, point out 20 of them. 20 of them. Point out 20 black leaders right now that are leading us not to the promised land, but are just leading us towards a black nation of abundance, depending on ourselves, unity, getting along. We not killing each other. We not going to their prison systems no more. We not dealing with that xenophobic type of thinking. Just show me where them motherfucking 20 black leaders are at. Show me. Show me. And then don't fucking try to ridicule me when I say Pac is my leader. That's what I looked at Pac when I was a young dude. And even now, I still look at him as such. Why? Because the lyricism is the message. And if I had the money to finance and shit like that, bro, this is probably why I'm doing what I'm doing right now. I don't do clickbait titles, bro. I could have made the title and say, yo, hell for a hustler. That shit would body anything Nas and Jay-Z got. You know how many people probably would have stormed this motherfucking live? Or if I would have said hell for a hustler, man, that shit would smash anything Eminem got. If I would have made some clickbait shit like these niggas do. Nah, I ain't on it like that. Fuck clickbait. I ain't on no clickbait shit like that, bro. Then he says, I live a troubled life, and we know that. No one knows my struggles. They only see the trouble. Not knowing it's hard to carry on when no one loves you. Let's finish this off.
And if you dream, be a part of my team. From Long Beach to Queens, drug dealers to ex-fiends.
And look at that. He just told you that he's a leader right there. He just, yo, cool, quick, like, all right, what's the question, bro? Oh, man, this nigga's a fucking idiot. This nigga says, quick, this weirdo says, quick question. Do it clap. Weirdos, bro. Where the fuck are these niggas, man? YouTube, where the fuck? Oh my God, bro. Let me, oh man, I wish I would have built YouTube. I'd be a wealthy motherfucker right now. And that shit would be, it probably would fall because I wouldn't allow the haters to live the way they did. If you ain't gonna have no intelligent dialogue, then get the fuck on. You know what I'm saying? If we can't have intelligent dialogue, then get the fuck on, man. You know what I'm saying? Like, real talk, bro. These motherfuckers on these social media websites, they stop you when you post a video and they got some music behind the video. You can't even post videos on Instagram and Facebook that's like 20 seconds long with some music playing in the background. These niggas would stop your video and mute the shit. And if you upload the video again, they'll stop you from posting. And if you do it one more time, they'll deactivate your account. These niggas got too much power over us. Too much. I'm even afraid at times I might lose this shit, what I'm trying to build right here. You know what I mean? It's like, it's just fucking crazy, bro. And then he says right here, and if you dream, be a part of my team. From Long Beach to Queens, to drug dealers to ex-fiends. So he said, be a part of my team. Tupac owns the team. This is the leader. You know what I mean? You want to be down, then follow me, my nigga. Do what I do. You know what I mean? Let's get this shit together. Let's get this shit popping, bro. He's telling you right there that he's a motherfucking leader.
Your eyes on the prize, nigga, watch for bust watch. You're heaven in jail, it's still here from a hustler.
And then finally, we ended that shit off. He says, and if you dream, be a part of my team. From Long Beach, I like that, from California to Queens. Even shouted out Queens. Drug dealers to ex-fiends. So the ex-fiends, niggas that got these, it could be any type of ex-fiend to tell you the truth. A fiend of what? Just a fiend of drugs? Or, long as you ain't fiending no more and you got your mind right, then be a part of his team. But keep your eyes on the prize and watch for busters. That's like these haters that come here. These niggas is busters, bro. Either heaven or jail is still hell for a hustler. And when he says either heaven, heaven is right here, earth. Heaven ain't in the clouds, bro. Heaven ain't none of that shit, bro. Heaven is right here. Heaven is right here. And that shit, hell is in the mind. Heaven is right here, but when you living amongst a race of human beings that's capitalistic, greedy, and, you know, man, bro, we pay for water. We pay for oranges and shit like that. We pay extreme. These niggas ain't create none of this shit, but we pay for it, bro. Them niggas created money and we believe in that shit. So they made it hell. They made it hell on earth. Like Mobb Deep album. They made it hell on earth. Whereas it's supposed to be a heaven. This shit is beautiful for us to enjoy, but they made this shit stressful. They made it hell for a hustler. And it's fucked up that you gotta hustle, my nigga. Keep it tall. It's fucked up that you gotta hustle. And life ain't supposed to be like that, like hustling just to get the money up and shit like that. It's a lot of shit that we don't know, my nigga. There's a lot of shit that we don't know about the wilderness. A lot of us don't travel. A lot of us just stay in the fucking hood, shooting at each other. We don't even make the guns. They do. But somehow, the devils do. So when you shooting, I got to bring it back. You know, the product cocaine, the product of the devil. Am I selling my soul? Shit, guns. A product of the devil. Am I selling my soul? Are you selling your soul when you just out here killing your niggas over some arguments, some dumb shit? Because you scared to throw the hands? You scared to fight? So he said, even heaven or hell, man. No, he said, even heaven or jail is still hell for a hustler. Heaven is the earth that we living on. You go to jail, man, that shit is really fucking hell. You ain't supposed to have niggas. You ain't supposed to have our people locked up. Nah, that shit was invented to have us locked up, but yet we still go. Yet we still give them reason to come here and arrest us. Fuck them. Damn, it's a lot of comments on here. Now let's listen to the whole shit.
Bustle of ever close and start living hella prison. Never losing my focus, I'm making money moves mandatory. In the discussion on past records, tell a story. Cause the niggas be rushing and still busting till the cops come running. Ducking my gun buildings, ditching my gun. Who with a motherfucking living? I live the lifestyles of drug dealers, but now legitly, so I laugh till I cry. Let the law come get me. No baby drama, drama, nigga, miss me. Why plant seeds in the dirty beach, waiting to trick me? Nothing like for me, living carefree till I'm buried. And if they dare me, I'm busting them niggas until they scurry. I'm landing, I'm in the military meetings and my artillery, watching over me through every murder scene. From adolescence to my early teens, thought we was gonna die.
selling dope to all the fiends. At times I wanna cry still. We try to chase the past in vain, never knowing if this game will last. Feeling the shame of cocaine, the product of the devil. I'm selling my soul, I got sell time living. Niggas telling me no, I got mine. That's the mother suckers, that's the mentality. Jealous ass busters, make it hell for a hustler. I ride the beat till I burn. Sesame and bar your kids from the lessons I learned. And in return, I'm a hot staff. Cause you can call me energy soldier. Niggas shaking it like they call the Holy Ghost. When I approach, I'm trying to politic before I smoke them like Sun Tzu. Niggas doing 2D stitches before it's done to you. And if the cops come arrest me in the evening, best believe they coming for my laws and I'm on it. And if I die by a slug, the death of a true thug. Tell me when my niggas moment getting blowed out. I watch me murder the bird before it testifies strike. Not the first or my third, I live a troubled life. And if you dream, be a part of my team. From Long Beach to Queens, drug dealers to ex-fiends. Keep your eyes on the prize, nigga, watch the busters. He's standing in jail, it's still hell for a hospital. I never let them take me for a buster, make a hell for a hustler. Lord, help me change my ways, show a little mercy, don't judge me then. I was raised this way, I never let them take me for a buster, make a hell for a hustler. This is how we ride, not knowing if we live or die. Catch me rolling with my motherfucking guns on the side. In case of trauma, I'm the first to break by till they all die. This is how we ride, if we live or die. Catch me rolling with my motherfucking guns on the side. In case of trauma, I'm the first to break wild until we all die. Outlaw.
I just got one more thing to say before I'm out of here. I just got one more motherfucking thing to say before I'm up out of here, because I'm about to be out of here in probably 2 minutes. This was a long motherfucking video, bro. So, it's like, once you break down, yo, let me say this first. Any haters that's here, do you feel good when you say some dumb shit? Even if it don't seem hate, a nigga says Taylor Swift made more than Tupac and Biggie. Is that important? So you really like to come here, say the dumb shit just so I can do this to you? It's just stupid, y'all weirdos. So you leave a fucking comment and you say some dumb shit, and then I gotta get you the fuck up out of here. Getting back to my point, once you break down the motherfucking lyrics, that's what anybody's, you listen to the motherfucking album, bro. You listen to anybody's album, but in this case, we talking about Tupac. You listen to the motherfucking lyrics, break that shit down, you know what I mean? Like I just did, and then you go back, then you really feel what the fuck Tupac was saying. You really feel every aspect of what that fire that was coming through his mind, that traveled through his arm, that came out of his hand, and focused on the pen to the fucking paper, bro. This nigga Tupac be spitting, man. Lord, help me change my ways. Mercy on judgment day. I was raised this way. I never let them play me for a buster, making hell for a hustler. So anyway, shout out to Raiden. Shout out to Storm, Kevin Robinson. Shout out to Thugger Velly. Shout out to John X. Shout out to JD, Jonathan Derby, Zachariah, Alex Lopez, Trebell in the building. Shout out to Positive Indifference in the building. Some other motherfucking nigga. They're fucking weirdos. Shout out to Jay in the building. My man Jay Jizzle in the building. nigga with this Kanye shit. All right, if I see any more haters, I ain't mention them. Brandon Heyman was in the building. Hip Hop for Life was in the building. K-H-E-M Kim was in the building. Briefcase Dirt was in the building. Hang Time was in the building. Slip and Roll Boxing was in the building. And I think Slim 400 was in the building. Pain 82 was in the building. And I think that's about it, man. About to be the fuck up out of here, bro. This is how we ride, not knowing if we live or die. Catch me rolling with my motherfucking guns on my side. In case the drama, I'm the first to break wild till they all. West Side. Storm, you said you asked me for my Cash App. I asked for help for a hustler. Somebody hit my Cash App requesting $50 from me. I was like, man, I ain't got no money to give. Change my ways. Never let them play me for a buster. Make it hell.